They're in a row. I don't. Yeah, they're already up there. I don't know which one you want to start first. You want to start this one first? No, 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 no. What you'll do is you'll do that one, and then you'll set all that, and then go to the next one. I'll have the volume all pretty well figured out by then. So, go from there. You got it. You got it.
Miranda, I believe, had an announcement this morning.
We are going to be doing a church directory. So for right now, we haven't done one in a number of years. So for right now, I need to save the dates. It's going to be October 2nd and 3rd, which is a Friday and Saturday. There's no football game on Friday night. But just for now, keep that date in mind, and then as it gets a little closer, there'll be more information on it. And so, from everything that I've learned so far, it's going to be really nice, and everything's going to go smooth, and every picture's taken. It's going to go smooth, everyone. And get your picture taken, and you go directly into viewing. And so you'll have everything before you as far as pricing and everything goes. So just be on the lookout for that.
Okay. Also, this Friday at 4 o'clock, there will be a wedding here at the church.
Yeah, we're
in the city at 4 o'clock. Reception following. Any other announcements on that? Just show up and be here. Okay. Any other announcements this morning? Okay. Birthdays this week. Little Rosa.
Now Mandy.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Okay, this week, the Baptist Search Committee, we placed ads in the Baptist Master, the Texas Baptist, and another publication in Texas about it. Across my mind. Also, the youth and Reed Radcliffe have created a website for our church, and this will aid in our ad. It references this website, so pastor who's looking at our church can go on there and look at what our community offers and our church offers. And there are several videos. I don't know if you guys have checked it out. We're going to watch them here in just a minute. What our church offers. And so that would be a great help in that. Then last Monday, you got to go to Falls Creek Roadshow. It was kind of put together pretty late. I kind of found out about it, and I'm like, hey, this is something I think we should go do. And we took 24 kids to Camp Gibson, which I hadn't been there since I was little. My grandparents used to run that place. And the only thing I can really remember was the tabernacle. And we showed up at 4:30, at 4 o'clock. We ate, we provided a meal there. Thank you for the church for paying then they kind of got hanging around, played basketball until 6 o'clock. And then here came the great flood. It poured for the whole time. It was basically in the tabernacle. And it caused some problems with the sound system, and they lost power a couple times, but it didn't really affect the atmosphere. And they took a little break, and they came back, and the speaker spoke, and we left there about 9:30. But it was just amazing to see kids from around this area. When you go to Falls Creek, you know, recognize a whole lot of kids, but there were kids that, you know, I've seen from other towns, and I know some of the kids, you know, and it was just amazing to see our kids in this area praise and worship God. And the decisions that were made were just incredible. Like I said, 8 out of 24 make decisions to follow Christ.
Since the first week that I got out of the hospital, a new one. I've spent my whole life in church.
One of my favorite memories of First Baptist Church for me is being able to go to Falls Creek as a student, now as an adult sponsor, and seeing kids accept Christ and growing their faith, and helping with the youth for many years, and seeing kids come back to Fording and still come back to church.
I think what makes me feel so welcomed at Fulton in our church was last summer when I went on the Falls Creek trip with a bunch of my friends. I had the intention that it was going to be nothing but fun. So excited. I was just ready to get out, but it really turned into so much more. It was more about finding ourselves and talking and opening up, and the people that went with us from the church just really cared and showed that they cared. And I just thought it was so special that I'd be able to come back to a place that they love me.
We start every Wednesday night at 6 o'clock with a family meal time, followed by a rotation of activities, a Bible study, Bible lesson, scripture memorization, and game time. At the end of Awanas, it's one of my favorite times, is when we come up, all of us meet together, come into the sanctuary, and we have a time of song, worship, and praise. And after the struggle of going through the hectic schedule, it is just kind of the calming central force of just pulling everybody together to worship God. It's just so special to my heart.
Showing the kids that, you know, we were all in their shoes at one time. And we love on them. And the kids love, especially when you give them the attention that they deserve, because they love God too.
And community that helps those in need. The church is a big part of that. They need and brother. Helping those in need, those the children, the elderly, and we just try to reach out.
What is your favorite part about coming to church here?
Like we go out and we share the gospel, and it's also great to see like ourselves grow and change in ourselves.
Just give me the opportunity to serve the Lord in the way that I love most, which is by singing and praising Jesus.
One day you'll know.
Church is the compassion and the love they have. As we had lost both of our daughters tragically, our church family surrounded us and were there through everything during and after, and still certain times it is my church family that gets me through the times that I would not think somebody thought I was hurting, and they somehow, for God, always finds a way of being there during that time. And that is truly what I love. They're want to be more Christ-like and love as Christ loved us.
Absolutely precious people. And whoever comes, you're going to love us today, and we're going to love you even more. And having the support of my church and my community really means everything, and I think it is really felt by everyone in the community.
The community, the people, the togetherness, the helpfulness of the people of the community.
Oh, they're just the community. What a nice people.
I think the fact that it's so loving and accepting of everyone, people care for each other, pray for each other, and the faithfulness this church has had in preaching God's word.
Just a wonderful community. community work because people get along well and try to help each other when there is somebody in need.
Father God, you are the great and mighty God. We come to you in a time of need. Our church needs a pastor to come and shepherd your flock here at Ford. We believe you have a plan for us. We have believe you have a plan for this pastor and his family. Lord, lead our search committee according to that plan. Lead this pastor and his family according to that plan. Bring your church and your pastor and his family into unity of mind and purpose and spirit, so that we might take the gospel here in the Oregon and to all the way othermost parts of the earth. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I see the stars.
This week's missionary of the week is Kenzie Hayward. Kenzie is a collegiate missionary with Oklahoma University in DCM. Our favorite verse is, I've been crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives within me. The life I now live in the body, I live by the faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the fact that you are faithful to work. We pray for you, God. We pray for you, God. We pray for our missionaries here and abroad, the work that they do in spreading the gospel. We pray especially for Kenzie and the work she does at the University of Oklahoma, ministering to the students on that campus. We just pray, God, that you would continue to guide, direct, and lead her in. These things we pray in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
talking to you guys about fire. In fact, I brought something with me that's designed to start a fire. Now, I'm not going to do it inside because that's just not smart. But this is a flint and steel. You take it and scrape it across and it creates sparks that can start a fire. Now, fire, even though it can be very scary, is also a thing that is used to help cook food, to help keep your house warm, to do a lot of things that are good, right? You see, God also compares his word, or the good news, the gospel, to a fire. Now, you gotta know how fire works a little bit to understand how that's important, right? Because fire doesn't just always sit in one spot. It moves around, the wind can spread it. There's three things you need for fire. You need air, oxygen, a fuel, so something, this is like wood or something, and then you need heat. You see, in order to share the gospel, you kind of need something like those things. Because when fire is doing what it's supposed to, it consumes the thing that's burning, right? You know, that's how our love for God is supposed to be. Our love for God is supposed to consume us and spread to other people. In Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 29, it says, "Is not my word like fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces?" You see, fire doesn't just sit on a thing without burning it up, right? Eventually, you don't really have much left of what it was burning. You have nothing more than a bunch of ash and maybe a little bit of it left. But most of it burns away, right? You see, when we are truly in love with Jesus, that's how it's supposed to be. There's not supposed to be any more evidence of who we were before. The only evidence that people are going to see is who we are after Jesus is done with us. You see, fire, it consumes. It spreads. It doesn't just stay in one spot. It's a living thing, or at least it acts like it's living. See, the gospel is a living thing. The gospel, the good news that Jesus came to earth, lived a perfect life, and died for your sins and for mine, is what we're supposed to go and tell everybody. And you see, this fire is supposed to spread. God didn't intend for it to sit in our hearts. He intended for it to be seen by others, because fire also provides light, right? It's intended to be seen by others so that more people will know who Jesus is. So my prayer for you guys is that you would be on fire for God, that you would have a desire to tell everyone you know about Jesus. Because if you truly have Jesus in your heart, that's going to be what you want to do. Because Jesus is awesome, right? I think we can all agree on that. If you know Jesus, you know that he is awesome. So why would you ever keep that to yourself when you can share it with everybody? So I want to leave you with this. Know who Jesus is. If you don't know who he is already, then ask your parents, ask Pastor Paul, ask any adult in his church, and I'm sure they will be happy to tell you. Because Jesus is really the most important thing. And if you guys will get on fire for Christ, and when you guys are on fire, you spread it to the entire school. So I want you guys to know that. So who would like to pray for us? Anyone else?
just awesome. That's something. Well, can you do better than that? You can scream your heads off at a basketball game. Let's learn to have the same energy for God. There are a lot of human authorities that rule over our lives. From the United States, the Office of President, the Senate, the Congress, the Supreme Court, from the state level, the governor, the legislature, the tax commission, locally the Beaver County, the Sheriff's Department, even we have a city of Corgan. So what do all these human authorities have in common? What do they have in common? All these authorities over all the, or rule over all the population of the United States. What is the common thread with all these authorities with God? Every authority that exists, is from God and established by God.
Amen.
In other words, God is the creator and the initiator of every authority. Look with me at Colossians, the book of Colossians, chapter 1. Verse 16, if you stand for the reading of God's word. Again, verse 15, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. We're talking about Jesus. For by him all things were created, both in heaven and on the earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. You may be seated. Thank you. Notice he says, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all of these things, all human authority, angelic authority, authorities of every kind, are established by God. Now, this morning we're going to study Romans chapter 13. You should be turning there if you would like. Romans chapter 13. And that text is focused on human authority. We know this based on the context of verse 6. Taxes are paid to the authorities. Well, obviously we don't pay taxes to angels. So when we look at Romans 13, verses 1 through 5, we're looking at human authority and God's ideal plan for those authorities. Now, these human authorities are ordained of God to preserve and order society, the people which in which they govern. So we have God's ideal here. From man's perspective, from you and I, we see that these authorities originate by human effort, by human power, force, or heredity, or by choice, by voting. So we think that men set up these authorities. But from God's perspective, every human authority and the process by which it is established is in the hand of God.
Amen.
He does it all. He does it all. So let's look at verse 1 in Romans 13. Every person is to be in subjection to the government authorities. For there is no authority except from God, and those which exist are established of God. God established all these authorities. Therefore what? Every person is to be subject to those authorities. If we believe the state of Oklahoma is established by God, then when they set the speed limit at 65, what are we to do? I didn't hear very many of you before. If God set up the human authority known as the state of Oklahoma, and the Oklahoma sets the speed limit 65, we're to drive what?
65.
Why? It's the law. Look at verse 2. Therefore, whoever resists the authority has opposed the ordinance of God. Whoever resists the authority opposes the ordinance of God. God made the rule. In essence, when you break the law of driving 65, you oppose God. Ooh. Isn't that what it said? Let's read it again. Therefore, whoever resists the authority, whoever resists the authority opposes the ordinance of God, in effect opposes God. Now, we need to understand that there's consequences when we oppose God. Does that make sense? That there's consequences when we oppose God? Look at verse 2 again. Therefore, whoever resists authority has opposed the ordinance of God. And they who have, now listen to this, and they who have opposed will receive condemnation upon themselves. They'll bring God wrath and punishment down upon themselves. Listen as I read from 1 Samuel chapter 15. I'm going to read you about Saul. Here's what it says in verse 11. Now, this is the word of God came to Samuel, and it says, this is God speaking. I regret that I have made Saul king, for he's turned back from following me and has not carried out my command. So what has he done? God set up Samuel as a king. He was the ruling authority. But what happened? He disobeyed God. Now listen to verse 26. But Samuel said to Saul, I will not return to you, for you have rejected the word of God, and the Lord has rejected you for being king over Israel. Saul's refusal to follow God ended up with the kingdom being taken away from him. He lost his authority. These are the consequences that Saul brought on himself. So, obviously, the consequences of resulting in resisting human authority and opposing God can be pretty severe. It's not just a ticket, always. It can be a lot more. But God doesn't desire for us to live in fear of human authority. You agree with that? God doesn't expect us to live in fear. Look at verse 3. Verse 3 of our text in Romans. Here's what it says. If I can get to it. For rulers are not a cause of fear for good behavior. For rulers are not a cause of fear for good behavior. God didn't assign human authorities be a terror to those who do good works. If you obey the speed limit, you don't have to worry about being afraid of the patrolman. You understand what I'm saying? But on the other hand, God did design human authorities to punish those who do evil. If you do good, you don't have anything to fear, but if you don't do good, if you oppose God, you're in trouble. Now look at the question Paul asks in verse 3. For the rulers are not a cause for fear for good behavior, but for evil. Do you want to have no fear of authority? How many would like to have no fear of authority? Amen?
Amen.
Well then do what's right. That's what it said. Do what is good, and you will have praise from the authority. Let me see if I can make this kind of make sense. If I go fishing and I get a license and I obey by the catch rule how many fish you get, and the game warden comes and checks me out, what's he going to say to me? You did good. You made the law. Have a nice day. What if I hadn't had a license? What if I caught too many fish? We need to understand that God does not want us to be in fear of authority unless we do what? Evil. Well, next we see Paul in this text wants us to see that human authorities God establishes are ministers of God for good. Look at verse 4. For it is a minister, now that it is refers back to verse 3 in the authority. Yet the authority is a minister of God for you for good. It is a minister of God for you for good. All human authorities are ministers of God for your benefit, for your best, to have the best life you can. God created these human authorities for the purpose of making life better for the people under their rule. But if we choose to do evil, then God has this word for us. Be afraid. Look at verse 4. For the authority is the minister of God to you for good, but if you do that, what is evil? What does it say? Be afraid. Why should those who choose to do evil be afraid? Well, look what it says next in verse 4. Why should you not be afraid? For the authority does not bear the sword for nothing. The authority does not bear the sword for nothing. What does he mean? He means that sword is not for show. It is for punishment. You understand? The authority, the human authorities, are given the power to govern and to swing that sword as punishment when necessary. Look at the very end of verse 4. For the authority, human authority, is a minister of God, an avenger who brings wrath on the one who practices evil. The minister of God, the human authority established by God, is an avenger, a punisher. We don't like those words, do we? Avenger, a punisher. The minister of God, this human authority, brings wrath and punishment down on those who practice evil. If you break the speed limit, you're going to pay the fine. If you commit murder, you're going to go to prison. If you don't pay your taxes, they're going to put a tax lien on your property. God's agencies, authorities, are an avenger for those who refuse to subject themselves to the authority set up by God. What's the importance of human authorities being punishers and avengers? What's God's purpose for these human authorities to have power to punish? That purpose is to keep law and order. Listen to Ecclesiastes chapter 8, verse 11. Ecclesiastes chapter 8, verse 11. Because the sentence against the evil deed is not executed quickly, therefore, the hearts of the sons of men among them are given fully to do evil. That sentence that he's talking about is the punishment. Punishment for evildoing. And notice it says, when the sentence, the punishment is not executed quickly. The problem is not that it wasn't executed. It wasn't executed quickly. Punishment has to be swift and quick. The longer it waits, what happens? If the punishment is put off and postponed, the hearts of the Son of Man among them are fully given to do evil. When there's no punishment and it's delayed, men become evil in their deeds. Isn't that what it's saying? Now, can we see the example of that in our big cities today? New York City, police arrest somebody. They turn them loose. There's no punishment. And what's happened to New York City? It's filled with crime. Record crime. Folks, understand this. God has given human authorities power to punish those who do evil. The power to punish is a deterrent to men doing evil, rejecting human authority that God has established. The avengers of God keep the law and order and protect our freedom. We need to understand that. Now let's look at verse 5 in our text. And let's see Paul draws the conclusion. Therefore it is necessary to be in subjection, not only because of wrath, but also because of conscience sake. Paul gives us two reasons to be in subjection to human authority. Now, first we need to not miss, he said it's necessary. It's necessary to be in subjection. Folks, it is not optional whether we subject to the authorities God has created or not. It is required. It is demanded of God. But look at the two reasons he gives it's necessary. First, because of wrath. Because of wrath. It is necessary to be in a subjection to governing authority because of wrath. In other words, that refers to the punishment of those practicing authority, practicing evil. It is necessary to be in a subjection to these authorities so as to avoid wrath and punishment. As we saw in verse 3 and 4, the person who subjects himself to has no reason to fear punishment. No reason. Yet respecting fear can motivate us to avoid things that harm us. Let me see if I can make this clear. Healthy fear enables us to control our fear. Unhealthy fear controls us. Let me illustrate it with a house on fire. You wake up in the middle of the night, the alarm's going off, there's smoke, there's fire, and what are you? What's your first reaction? You're fear. You're afraid. Amen? That's natural. And naturally, fear, if it's healthy, would cause you to do what? Get out and run. Run out of the house. Protect yourself. That's healthy fear. What is unhealthy fear? You wake up, the alarms are going off, the fire is burning, and you're afraid and you freeze. You can't do anything because you're frozen in fear. And what happens? You die. That's unhealthy fear. Healthy fear respects the danger and motivates us to avoid the danger. When we understand God's agency of authority, our avenger, we should have some fear. How many of you, when you're driving down the road and see the patrol car, you let up off the gas? Why? Because healthy fear motivated you to protect yourself so you don't get a ticket. If you didn't have fear, you would have kept driving. Some of you do, but you keep driving. But anyway, we must avoid punishment. Let God's natural fear he gives us, his healthy fear, cause us to subject ourselves to this authority. The second thing is we're to be in a subjection because of conscience sake. Look at verse 5 again. Therefore, it is necessary to be in subjection not only for wrath, but also for conscience sake. This conscience sake refers to the believer's knowledge of the Word of God, the will and purpose of God. It also refers to the guidance of the Holy Spirit. We have both. We have the Word of God and we have the Holy Spirit. And that conscience, because of that, it is necessary to subject ourselves. We must submit ourselves to these authorities. Now, that means that we use the Bible and the Holy Spirit to drive us, to cause us to drive the speed limit, to buy a fishing license, to pay taxes, and to obey when the policeman tells you to pull over or gives you command. That's what that conscience does. Now, there's an issue that we must address that's not in this text. And that is that all of us live in tension of two primary authorities that control our life. One is obviously the authority of God, his absolute sovereign authority over our lives. And the second is all the human authorities that God has established over our life. We could spend all day numbering and talking about how many they are. But there's two basic authorities, God and all the human authorities that rule over us. Both of these authorities originate from God and are established from God. We saw that in verse 1. Therefore, God's authority and human authority ought to walk, be in agreement. Right? Amen? You with me? If God made it, it ought to be agreement. They ought to be, but too often, what? It's not in agreement. The purposes and will of the human authority is not the same as God. What's the problem? The problem is God gave us free will choice. And these leaders were given their authority by God, and they choose not to follow it. That's what Saul did, didn't he? Same situation. This leads to the purposes of human authorities failing to agree with the purposes of God's authority. So the question comes, are we still to submit? When the human authority doesn't agree with God's authority anymore, at what point do we cease to submit? There's an example in Acts chapter 5, verse 29. The high priest had commanded Paul, Peter and the others not to teach Jesus, not to proclaim the word of God. And most of you know what Peter responded. He said, we must obey God rather than man. We must obey God rather than man. We see this playing out on the news in the last couple of days. If you've watched the news, the several governments, state governments, are trying to shut churches down while they let casinos and others mass gathering, but they're closing the churches. And those pastors, John MacArthur, Jeffries up at First Baptist, Dallas, they're refusing. Why? This very reason. We must obey God rather than man. Hear what I'm trying to say. The necessity of believers to subject themselves to human authority is not absolute. What do I mean by that? Christians don't blindly subject themselves to every human authority. There's some work we have to do. The Christian must decide if the human authority is truly following God's established purposes or not. And when the Bible and the Holy Spirit convince us that the purposes of that authority agree with the purposes of God, then it is a necessity that we submit to that authority. It's not an option. Now, I need to give you a word of caution. We're good at this. To nitpick at something until we find a problem so we don't have to do something we don't want to do. Y'all hear what I'm saying? If you look hard enough, you'll find a problem with every human authority. How do I know that to be true? Because they're people. They're sinners. So what do we do in this tension between we've got to do what God says and yield to these authorities, but they're not always in line with God? How do we deal with it? Well, as we study this ideal, we understand that as much as possible, we must submit to governing authority. Every chance we can give it, we submit to the governing authority over our life because God made it. We can't nitpick our way out of it to do something just because we want to do it. Until the Bible and the Holy Spirit convince us to not subject, we must subject ourselves. As I did this study, studied these verses, I kept wondering what has happened to our country. What has happened? I looked at our leaders of these human authorities, and I'm not going to name them. But they slander each other, they defame each other, they don't do what's best for the people. And I'm a pretty simple country boy, I can figure out some of this. You sure think these bigwigs can figure it out. What is our country coming to? And I think what's scary the most is this, what do they call it, cancel culture, where you cancel somebody out. I thought this country was based on freedom of speech. Didn't you think that? What has happened to our country? And then I asked God, what can I do? A simple little guy living in Oregon, Oklahoma. What can our church do? Have you thought about that? What can we actually do? Well, God helped me see two things. Let's go to 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11 through 15. Let's look at these verses. Beloved, I urge you as aliens and strangers to abstain from fleshly love. That's put off the old man that Paul always uses. Put your sin nature aside. Verse 12, and keep your behavior excellent. Keep your behavior. Put on the new man. Put on the Christ likeness. So we're to put off that old stuff, and we're to put on being Christ-like, right? Amen? Then look at what it says in verse 13. Submit yourself for the Lord's sake to every human institution. Isn't that what we just got through studying? Isn't that the same thing? It's God created and established, so we have to submit in Romans 13, 1. Same thing. But notice it ordered, it said, for the Lord's sake. Now, if you look down in verse 14, he said, this, what you submit yourself for is the punishment of evildoers and the praise of those who do right. That's the basic purpose of God for all authority. Punishment of evildoers and doing what? Doing what's right. Light goes off. God wants us to do what? Do what's right. How many of you know what's right? Raise your hand. If you know Moses, could you lie? Are you supposed to lie? Are you supposed to defame somebody else? Insult them? We could go right there. Do what's good. That includes subjecting ourselves to these authorities. And that's for God's benefit. We do what's good. As much as we can, as much as we can, we submit to every human authority that God has established. We must trust that God will punish the evildoers and he will vindicate those who do right. Do you believe that? Amen. There's coming a day, a time when God will take care of the evil.
Amen.
And he will vindicate. I like that. You know what that word means? It means we win. Amen. And all that screaming and hollering that we do when we win, that's coming in January to me. And ultimately, God is glorified. So the first thing we need to do is just do what's right. I can handle that. Amen?
Amen.
I just need to do what's right. Second thing, and I'll get you out of here. Look at 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 4. 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 4. First of all, then, I urge you in treaties and prayers and petition and thanksgiving be made on behalf of all men and for kings who are in authority, that they may lead a tranquil and quiet life in all godliness and dignity. He says, pray every kind of prayer for all men and for governments. Right?
Amen.
Basically. Every kind of prayer, and this is a priority. What do you say? First of all, I think. First of all, with every kind of prayer that you know how to pray, pray for all men that's lost and saved. Obviously, we pray for the lost to be saved and for the saved to be rich in the gospel, right?
Amen.
And doing what's right. Do what's right. But why do we pray for government? Why do we pray for, look at it, for kings and all who are in authority, those authority God sets up, that we may lead a tranquil and quiet life. Remember, God gave us the authority for our benefit to have a good life, to live in order and peace and freedom. So we're to pray that these human authorities follow the will of God, right? You see that? My prayer life ought to include, God, I pray for all the lost. God, I pray for the saved. God, I pray for all the human authorities so that there'll be an atmosphere and environment for Christians to live and proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That's what government's all about. Now, a lot of government don't know that anymore. They've lost sight of that. But that's what it's about. Prayer. God wants us to pray to maintain law and order and freedom. God wants this gospel to be proclaimed and received with all openness and unhindered. Look at the book of Acts. We'll close with this verse. Acts chapter 28. Now let's begin at verse 30. Acts 28, 30. And he went, this is Paul, stayed 2 full years in his own rented quarters and was welcoming all who came to him. He was in the Roman captivity. Verse 31. Preaching the kingdom of God and teaching concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. With what? All openness unhinderedly. No restriction. Totally open, free to preach the gospel. That's the purpose of these human authorities. That's the purpose of our reading. Some of you here today, if you were to look at your life, you're under and subject to the avengers, the punisher, because you refuse to subject yourself to the gospel. You refuse to accept Christ as your Savior. If you're that person today, you can change that real simple by confessing Jesus, believing that this gospel of Jesus Christ is true, that he died for your sins and rose for your life. Believe it so much that you turn and repent to God from sin. And you ask God to save your soul. It's that simple. And if you're here today and that's all you got to do is say, God, save my soul. I believe Jesus died for me. You come and take control of my life. Be Lord. If you're here, well, we have this invitation that this team would come. Bless you pray right while we're having it. You need to come and talk. You come pray with me. If you're a Christian, let's pray for each other to do right. Amen?
Amen.
Let's stand.
Thank you. Yeah, you did. How are you?
You doing good, Michelle?
Pretty good, Michelle.
Hey, what are you doing?